Good day to all of you and welcome to my first lecture on the fifth module of engineering physics, that is material science. I am Dr. Vincent Crasta, professor from the Department of Physics, St. Joseph Engineering College, Mangalore. First, let us look into what are the table of contents of the topic. In this topic, we deal with the classical free electron theory, a qualitative approach. The second topic is the quantum free electron theory of metals. The third is physics of semiconductors. And the last topic is material science. And these are the four topics that we are coming across in the module 5. So let us try to see what are exactly the objectives of the module 5 topic. The first is to explain the classical and free electron theory of metals. The second is to interpret the Fermi factor corresponding to different conditions. The third, to derive the expression for electrical conductivity in semiconductors. The fourth, to enumerate the fundamentals of dielectric materials. And the last, to solve the problems related to dielectric and electrical conductivity of metals and semiconductors. Now let us start our topic. I'm going to deal with the conductivity of metals, or in general conductivity of any elements. First of all, the first question comes to our mind, what is a conductor? A material which allows the electricity to pass through is what we call as a conductor. We have got various kind of examples, the most conducting elements. Like the example what we have is a silver, is one of the very good conductor. Then comes to the copper, gold, aluminium, beryllium, calcium, magnesium, rhodium, sodium, iridium. You know, these are the various kind of conducting elements where they allow the electricity to pass through. Now in this topic, I must find how this material is able to conduct the electricity. To understand the conduction of the electricity, let us start from the beginning. The most fundamental entity of any given matter, that is from atom. We are aware an atom consists of a central nucleus surrounded by the negatively charged electrons. Where within nucleus there are protons and there are neutrons, where protons are considered to be positive charged particle and the electrons are moving around the given nucleus having negative charged particle, and the neutrons within them are neutral, they don't have any charges within it. And this is exactly the look of an atom, where there are protons and neutrons are being at the center and all these electrons are moving around in the various different orbits. Every electron or a proton has got a charge of 1.602 into 10 to the power minus 19 coulomb. And the mass of the electron is 9.1 into 10 to the power minus 31 kg. It is the smallest particle having a very small mass. And these electrons in the top or outermost orbit, which we call as the free electrons. The electrons which you find at the outermost orbit are what we call as the free electrons. Let us try to see what is a classical approach to understand the conductivity of any metals. And this classical approach was explained by two well-known physicists, and one is Paul Drude, a German physicist, and the other one is Hendrik Lorentz, a Dutch physicist. And this classical theory is also been named after them, that is Drude-Lorentz theory. Now this theory is going to tell us about what is a classical approach to explain the conductivity of metals. Now we have come across the various kind of metals. I said copper is a metal, silver is a metal, aluminium is a metal, iron is a metal. The question comes to our mind whether the conductivity of all these metals is the same or different. Naturally, they are different. We have just now seen that the silver is one of the best conductor, then comes to the copper, then comes the other kind of elements. What makes the silver a best conductor compared to that of copper? Or what makes a copper atom to be a better conductor than that of aluminium? So we require to understand what are exactly the basic concept of the conductivity of metals. And this theory, classical theory, is the olden theory where this theory said a metal is made of atoms. We are all aware that every metals in general, they are all made of atoms. And in each atom, there are large number of electrons are there. But the outermost electrons, what we call as the valence electrons, are the only responsible particles or the charged particle which are important for the electrical conduction. That means all the electrons in a given metal are not able to take part in the conducting process. But only the valence electron which are present at the outermost orbit are the only responsible particle which are going to take part in the conducting process. Let us try to take an example, a copper. A copper element has got 29 electrons. So how do we fill these electrons? These electrons can be filled in any given atom in accordance with an equation called 2n square. Here 2n square, n is called as a principal quantum number. When I say n is equal to 1, 1 square into 2, that means in the first orbit, a maximum of 2 electrons can be accommodated. In the second orbit, n is equal to 2, so n square into 2 becomes 8, so there are 8 electrons can be accommodated. But when I say n is equal to 3, 3 square into 2, that means there are 18 number of electrons that have been accommodated. So this is how the filling of the electrons that is going to take place. Therefore, in the case of copper, in the first orbit you see there are 2 electrons. In the second orbit you find there are 8 electrons. And in the third orbit you find 18 electrons. Altogether 20 electrons are completely filled. And these 28 electrons are called as bound electrons. And there you find at the core of the given atom. And these 28 electrons are not going to take part in any conducting process. But you see, in the last orbit, there is one electron. And that electron is called as a valence electron. And this valence electron is responsible for the conducting of copper metal. So let us try to see how the classical free electron theory explains the conductivity in general when a metal is having large number of atoms. Let us try to take the same example, where every atom of copper is going to contribute one electron. And when all these atoms are being brought one closer to the other atoms, then you can see the atoms are able to overlap one over the other. Here you can see very clearly there is an overlapping of the atoms that is going to take place, where every one atom is going to contribute one electron. This is the electron that you find. Okay, so every one atom is going to contribute one electron, where in a whole metal, these all atoms are able to overlap. And because of this overlapping of the energy levels, the valence electrons move easily throughout from one end to the other corner, because the energy of the electron in one orbit is the same as that of the energy of the electron in the other orbit. Therefore, the electron is easily able to travel from one atom to the other atom. This is how exactly electron is easily able to travel from one atom to the other atom. So these electrons are easily able to move throughout the entire metal. And because of this, you can see there is electricity, there is a conduction that is going to take place. It is just because of the randomness of the movement of the electrons in the various orbits. And here the randomness is that there are some few number of electrons able to travel from the left to right, or there are also number of electrons able to move from the right to left. or from the top to bottom, or from bottom to up. So there is a random motion of these electrons, and due to this, that there is no net velocity of the electrons. But when these electrons are being applied by some amount of electric field, the electrons are able to drift in the opposite direction as that of the direction of the electric field. Why? Because electrons are considered to be negative charged particles. When an electric field is applied between the two ends of a given conductor, the electrons always travel from the lower field to the higher field. That means from the negative towards the positive. That is the reason that electrons are always drifting in a direction opposite to the direction of the electric field. And because of this drifting, there is a net current. Therefore, I can say a conductor is going to have current only and only in the presence of an external electric field. But in the absence of an external electric field, there is no current because the net drift velocity of an electron is going to be equal to zero. So a conductor is able to conduct only in the presence of an external electric field. But to understand this conductivity based on the classical approach, let us try to understand what are the assumptions of the classical free electron theory. Drude and Lorentz together brought out this theory, and to understand this theory, there were certain assumptions made. Now, what are exactly the assumptions made? The first assumption is that every electron within a metal is considered to be similar to a gas molecule. You know, a gas molecule is easily able to travel from one corner to the other corner without having any opposition. It is freely able to move. An electron also is very similar, that it is able to move from one corner to the other corner within the surface of the material. That means surface is the boundary of the material. That is the first assumption of the classical free electron theory. The second assumption is that the motion of the electron is so random such that the kinetic energy of the electron is equal to the kinetic energy of a gas molecule. You know, in the absence of the electric field, there is no current. I is going to be equal to zero. The kinetic energy of an electron is given by half mv square, and the kinetic energy of a gas molecule is 3 by 2 kT. Therefore, you can say here that half mv square is equal to 3 by 2 kT, or 2 to get cancelled there. So, mv square is equal to 3 kT. That means the motion of the electron is so random, where the kinetic energy of the electron and the kinetic energy of a gas molecule going to be equal. That is the second assumption. The third assumption is that when these electrons are able to travel from one corner to the other corner, you know, electrons are being negative charged particle. You have studied about the electrostatic repulsion between the like charged particle. Here the electrons being negatively charged particle, when they travel from one end to the other end, there is a repulsion taking place. But here in this case, their classical theory says that the repulsion between the two electrons should be neglected. Or when an electron is going to move, there is a lattice ion, a positive ion. Naturally, there is an attraction between an electron and a lattice ion, and even the attraction between the electron and the lattice ion to be ignored. That is the third assumption of the classical free electron theory. And the last assumption is that when you apply an electric field, you have to assume that the potential due to these lattice ions is constant throughout the crystal. That means the electric field is assumed to be constant throughout the entire crystal. So these are the four assumptions that have been made to explain the classical free electron theory. So let us look into, based on this classical free electron theory, how the conductivity of a mini given conductor has been explained. We have studied the Ohm's law. The Ohm's law says that when you apply a potential between the two ends of a given conductor, then the drop of this potential is directly proportional to the current, or in general V is equal to IR, where I is the current, R is the resistance of the material. And based on this Ohm's law, in your lower classes you have studied and you have derived this equation that the conductivity of any given conductor is given by the equation N E square tau divided by M, where sigma is the conductivity, N is the free electron concentration, which means to say that it is the number of free electrons present in the given conductor per unit volume of the material. Tau is called the mean collision time, or it has also been named as the relaxation time. Mean collision time is the time taken between the two successive collisions. See, when an electron is going to move from one corner to the other corner, electrons are able to collide with the lattice ions. So you try to take the average time taken by the electron between the two successive collisions is called the mean collision time or relaxation time. And m is exactly the mass of the electron. Therefore, based on the classical free electron theory, it clearly says that the conductivity of a metal depends on the number of electrons present in the material. The relaxation time or the mean collision time of the electrons in the material, however, E, that is the electronic charge, and the mass of an electron is a constant. It is independent of the material. Therefore, sigma is N e square tau divided by M is the equation for the conductivity of a given metal. But based on that, whether the classical free electron theory is successful in explaining the conductivity, let us try to understand what are the failures of the classical free electron theory. Classical free electron theory failed in many ways to explain the conductivity of material. Let us try to see two failures. I am not going to explain all the different failures, even if there are plenty of failures. But let us try to understand two failures. And the first failure is the temperature dependence of the electrical conductivity. So let us try to understand how a metal is able to conduct based on the temperature. Experimentally, if you see, the resistivity of any given material is directly proportional to the temperature. If you look into the resistance of a material, the resistance of a material always increases with the increase in the temperature, or the resistivity of a material increases with the increase in the temperature. And if you see, the resistivity is always reciprocal to the conductivity. Therefore, I can very clearly say that the conductivity is reciprocal to the temperature. So experimentally, we observe that sigma is always reciprocal to the temperature. That means, as the temperature rises, the conductivity of a metal decreases. Naturally, you see in each and every kind of material. Now, the question is that whether the classical free electron theory explains the same. Let us look into what exactly the classical free electron theory is going to tell us. As per the classical free electron theory, we have just come across that the kinetic energy of an electron is very similar to the kinetic energy of a gas molecule. That is, half mv square is equal to 3 by 2 kT. Here 2 and 2 get cancelled, and from this equation that you can very clearly see that Vth is directly proportional to the square root of the temperature. Vth is nothing but it is the thermal velocity of the electron, and it is directly proportional to the temperature. That means, more and more exactly is the temperature, naturally the thermal velocity of the electron is going to increase. Therefore, what is the equation for the conductivity? We have already come across sigma is equal to N e square tau divided by M. That is the equation that we already come across. And this equation is going to tell us that sigma is proportional to tau, where tau is nothing but the relaxation time. Because with respect to temperature, N is not going to change. The charge of an electron is not going to change. M is the mass of the electron is not going to change. Therefore, sigma is only proportional to tau, where tau is the mean collision time or the relaxation time. But we are aware, time, tau, and the velocity, that is the thermal velocity, are always reciprocal. Therefore, tau is inversely proportional to the thermal velocity. But as per the above equation, that is Vth is directly proportional to the square root of the temperature. Therefore, 1 by Vth is directly proportional to 1 by the square root of temperature. Hence, I can say sigma is inversely proportional to the square root of the temperature. Now, you try to see the two relations. The one relation experimentally, sigma is reciprocal to the temperature. And as per the classical theory, sigma is reciprocal to the square root of the temperature. And from this, it is very clear that there is no agreement between the classical theory as well as the experimental theory. Therefore, this is one of the reasons that the classical free electron theory failed. So classically, we see that sigma is reciprocal to the square root of the temperature. That means when the temperature becomes 4 times, the conductivity is going to reduce 2 times. But the experimental observation says that when the temperature increases 2 times, the conductivity decreases by half. So there is no clear agreement between the classical as well as experimental theory. Hence, this is the first failure of the classical free electron theory. Let us try to see what is the second failure of the classical free electron theory, and that is the dependence of electrical conductivity on electron concentration. Electron concentration is nothing but it is the number of electrons per unit volume of the material, that is N. So let us look into the various example. I will try to take the first element as the copper. We are aware copper is a monovalent element. A monovalent is the one electron at the last orbit or one valence electron. The second example that I would like to give you is a zinc. Zinc is a divalent where there are 2 electrons at the last orbit or valence electrons, and the aluminum has got 3 valence electrons. Now you look into what are the total number of electrons present per unit volume of the material. In the case of copper, the total number of free electrons present in the material is 8.45 into 10 to the power 28 per meter cube. So these are the total number of free electrons are present per unit volume of the material. But if you look into the zinc, the number of electrons are going to be more. It is 13.10 into 10 to the power 28 per meter cube. Why? Because zinc is a divalent. It has got 2 electrons per atom. Copper has got 1 electron per atom. Naturally, the zinc has to have more number of electrons. Aluminum being trivalent, it has got much more number of electrons, that is 18.06 into 10 to the power 28 per meter cube. So now we can see here, the number of electrons per unit volume of the material in the case of copper is less, zinc is more, and aluminum is maximum. Now what is a classical approach? The classical approach says sigma is proportional to N. That means the one which has got the maximum number of electrons is the best conductor. Sigma is proportional to N. So according to that, aluminum should be a best conductor. So aluminum would have been a best conductivity. Next is the zinc and next is the copper. But let us try to see what is the actual conductivity of any given material. In the case of copper, the conductivity of copper is 5.87 into 10 to the power 7 Siemens per meter. That is the conductivity, and we know the copper is a better conductor. The aluminium has 3.69 into 10 to the power 7 Siemens per meter. Its conductivity is less. And you can very clearly see that even if the aluminium has got more number of electrons, but its conductivity is lesser than that of the copper. And you look into in the case of zinc, the conductivity is 1.09 into 10 to the power 7 Siemens per meter. So one thing is very clear. Classically, one says that the material which has got the large number of electrons should be the best conductor. So in the 3 examples which are mentioned, aluminium would have been the best conductor, then the zinc, then the copper. But you see, copper is the best conductor, then the aluminium and the zinc. And you can very clearly understand that the classical approach of explaining the conductivity of metal failed. So this is the second failure of the classical free electron theory. Now the question comes that if this is the failure, how do we able to explain the conductivity of any given metal? What makes copper to be a better conductor than that of aluminium, and aluminium to be a better conductor than that of zinc? Classically, it is failed, but we require to understand the actual concept behind the conductivity of metals and a new theory that was developed, and that is the quantum free electron theory by a well-known theoretical physicist named Arnold Sommerfeld, a German physicist, in the year 1928. And he succeeded in overcoming the drawbacks of the classical free electron theory using a very simple principle, a well-known principle named Pauli's exclusion principle. And here he says that electrons in an atom are distributed in various shells as well as subshells. That means In the classical approach, we have considered an atom which has got only energy levels. They have just shells. But quantum approach going to tell us that it doesn't have only shells, but it also have the subshells. Therefore, are we able to fill the electrons like the classical concept? No. The filling of the electrons is going to take place based on a principle given by a well-known Austrian scientist named Ernest Pauli. And this principle is called the Pauli's exclusion principle. This principle says, no two or more identical fermions, that means the particles with half integer spin, can occupy the same quantum state within a quantum system simultaneously. That means you cannot accommodate more than two electrons in any energy state. If you go back to the chemistry and try to understand the various energy states of an electron, an electron has got four different kind of energy states. The first one is called the principal quantum state. The second one is called the azimuthal quantum state. The third one is called as the magnetic quantum state. And the fourth one is called the spin quantum state. So these are the four energy states in which an electron can have. Now, whether these electrons are identical, we are aware electrons are indistinguishable particles. Means you are not at all able to distinguish between one electron with other electron. Since they are indistinguishable particles, their energy states are not going to be the same. Therefore, in accordance with the Pauli's principle, who says, whenever you try to fill the electrons, you cannot accommodate more than two electrons. That is one thing. Not only that, even those electrons cannot be identical in terms of their quantum states. That means, imagine in a state, if there are two electrons, at least their spin quantum state must be different from one another. If you consider one electron has a positive spin or a clockwise spin, the other electron will have a negative spin or what we call as an anti-clockwise spin. Therefore, no electrons are identical. Here the fermions where I can speak about the electrons. So no electrons are identical in any quantum state. That is what exactly the Pauli's exclusion principle is all about. And to explain this quantum free electron theory, there are certain assumptions being made. Let us try to understand all these four assumptions. The first assumption, what you can see here, is that the energy levels of the conduction electrons are quantized, and it is very important. You must understand the word what is called quantization. The word quantization is nothing but it is a discreteness. Every energy levels of the electrons are quantized or discrete. That means every energy must have a very specific discrete energy. It cannot have a continuous energy like in the case of classical mechanics, but it has to have a discrete energy. The second is that the distribution of the electrons in the various energy levels should be in accordance with the Pauli's exclusion principle. That means you cannot accommodate any number of electrons as you like. You can accommodate a maximum of two electrons in each energy state, and that too, they cannot be identical. They must be different, at least in terms of their spin. So a maximum of two electrons can be accommodated in any energy state. The third and the fourth assumptions are very similar to the classical free electron theory, where electrons travel in a constant potential inside the metal but stay confined within its boundaries. That means they are very free to move any place within the metal. They are not able to go out because the boundaries are being confined. And the last is that the attraction between the electrons and the lattice ions and the repulsion between the electrons once again to be ignored. Therefore, the third assumption and the fourth assumptions are very, very similar to the classical approach. But the first two assumptions, that is the energy levels quantization and the distribution of the electrons in accordance with the Pauli's exclusion principle, is something different than that of the classical approach. So let us try to conclude the subjects that we learned today on the classical free electron theory. And we are aware that the classical free electron theory failed to explain the conductivity of materials. Thank you very much.